meeting of the City of Montpelier Development Review Board to order. My name is Phil Zallinger. I serve as chair. The other members here this evening to my right are
Jack Lilly.
James Lavanga.
Sarah McShane, staff.
Roger Kranz.
Kate McCarthy.
Thank you. We need to identify the five voting members who may participate in any decision that's taken tonight. Since there's only five members in attendance, we will need the five members who act in conjunction with any action taken tonight. Is there a motion to approve the agenda?
So moved.
Motion by James. Second by Kate. All those in favor, please signify by raising their right hands. Agenda's been approved. Comments from the chair. I'm going to ask the members of the DRB if what their sense is regarding the application for at 100 State Street. Is it your pleasure to go into deliberative session once the record is closed?
I would think I'm certainly complex enough.
Is that a motion, James?
Yes, so moved.
Motion by James. Second by Jack. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising their right hands. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes on March 19th. I was not in attendance, but Dan was here, Jack, Roger, James, and, well, Dan's not here this evening, but Jack, Roger, James, and Kate were here. So you can review and approve the minutes.
Will they be accepted as printed?
Second.
Motion by Jack, second by Roger. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your right hands. No, it's four. Next item on the agenda is continuation of review of the project at 100 State Street, Capital Plaza Corp. Good evening.
Good evening.
Before we begin, I see there's some other new folks here. Anyone who's been sworn in previously to give testimony on this matter remains sworn in, but for those of you who have not appeared or testified previously, please raise your right hands if you wish to testify. You solemnly swear the evidence you're about to give on the matter under consideration is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you. Since this has been a serial presentation, I'll tell you what happened in the last installment. The DRB approved the grant of a variance for the siting of the parking garage structure. South east corner of the parcel.
Yes.
Which leaves still on the DRB's agenda site plan, design review, and conditional use review of the project. Roger, the floor is yours.
Thank you for your time this evening. I guess for the benefit of the public and to help remind the board, I'll just quickly go over the site plan again.
Can everyone hear me? So the project proposal is at 100 State Street. Here's the existing Capital Plaza complex. The project contains two principal parts, a new build, five-story, 81-room hotel to be operated by the Capital Plaza Corporation under the Hampton Inn and Suites franchise. Also included in the project is a 230 space parking garage, which will serve the public, the project, and whoever else comes, I guess. There's a calculated value of 160 parking spaces, I believe, required for the project. So in addition to the 230 spaces in the garage, there are 56 spaces on the surface. That's the correct number, 56. Surface spaces, including access to the back of the existing hotel, and some surface spaces for the businesses that are currently on the ground floor of Capitol Plaza. So there's a couple of hair places, several offices for various functions, and of course the restaurant and hotel functions as well. When we met with you, I think
the development, the work that has happened on the project since the last time we presented to this board has focused mainly on the execution of parking structure, and also in forming a cooperative relationship with the folks at Christ Church Episcopal, or Christ Episcopal Church, sorry. We have been in an ongoing series of discussions with them that we hope will result in a memorandum of understanding between the parties. I expect that improvements that are required on the church property in order to facilitate development of this area in general, and this project, but the church also has plans for a future project, that at some future date, the church will come forward with a application for improvements on their land, some of which may be predicated by this project, but all of which would be entirely sort of contained in their own application. That may or may not be part of the larger application to develop apartments on the back of the church property. I don't think there's a firm timing on that yet, but that's certainly their expressed intention. And so a lot of our work with them has been just dealing with nuts and bolts issues. We're going to ask that process continue apart from this process. We're not asking for an official sanction on the MOU or anything like that, but I think that is the vehicle that we're using to sort of tie off all the loose ends between ourselves and the church. There are still information that needs to be collected, so the church has their consultants. Their consultants are cooperating with us and our team of consultants to iron that stuff out, and I think we've made a lot of progress. We're not at 100% in that MOU, but I feel like we are at a point where the project is ready for approval. I mentioned that the largest changes to the project were in the detailing of the garage. Part of that was intended to accommodate the concerns of the church if they ever built an apartment building on the back of the church building. But the biggest innovation that's happened, as I believe, is the introduction of a living wall system as part of the exterior skin of the garage. And the drawings you see show how that's intended to work. I also brought you a copy of this section here.
Mr. Rowder, I think one of the speakers.
Oh!
Very close to your materials.
Sorry.
It might be that just to the right.
Is that better?
I think it's going to be better.
I'm so sorry about that. But you have a sheet in your set that looks like this. I handed out colored copies tonight. I didn't know if you got color or black and white by it, you know. But that's intended to show how the garage...
Is that L101?
That is labeled L101, landscape sections. And that shows the relationship of the parking garage to the bicycle path. It shows the relationship of the parking garage to the church property. But the most important thing, this elevation on the top of the page, showing how the design of the garage has been modified to incorporate living materials as part of the building itself. And I actually have a sample of what that system looks like, how it goes together. Get it out of the box and we'll break it. So this is the principal component of the building. And that's used as a framework for living things to grow on. One condition we got that the design advisory board was very positive about this, and I'm sure you have their comments separately, but they did impose one condition in their approval, and that was that we incorporate more evergreen materials into the plantings on these green walls, essentially including some Boston ivy and some other things that hold their their leaves year-round. And the landscaping plans, the schedule submitted, address that change. The hotel building itself hasn't changed a lot since we've seen you last. You know, we've continued to develop the interior guts of the thing, but it is still a mixture of stone and brick and some siding. All the colors are essentially a variation on a theme of white. I did bring an actual sample palette of proposed materials, showing the buff Indiana limestone in a smooth finish, the white brick, and then we're going to have white siding. The only other component is the, we'll use black for all our window components and for the roof, components of the mansard roof where the dormers are shown on the windows. I'll acknowledge that while we have shown signs on the application materials, that we're not seeking approval for signs tonight, and we don't expect that if you granted approval that that would include the signs, but I thought I'd mention that since it did matter at the staff level. So we need to address the site plan issues tonight, and hopefully if we have time, I guess we still have to go through the conditional use determination. I do have a limited time frame with our landscape architect, so if any of the members of the commission have specific questions about landscaping, I'd like to move those up in the order of things. Other than that, I will mention a couple of last things. Ron Lyon from Dubois & King is here. He's been in regular consultation with the Department of Public Works. I'm going to invite him up to say a few things about where things stand with Public Works and all the various plumbing issues. Other than that, I think I would like to just answer questions and see if there's anything you need from us in order to feel comfortable making a decision.
Thanks. I guess our preference is to go forward in a linear fashion. Our jurisdiction derives from specific provisions of the statute. So instead of just jumping around or from one to the other, first I'd like to ask if there's anyone here who has any general statements to make about the project.
I didn't have an agenda to know where that fit.
We're making it up as we go along. Just identify yourself for the record,
please. Stephen Whitaker, 26 years in Montpelier, longer than that, in Vermont. I used to serve on a regional planning commission. I've been to planning school at the Woodbury College program. I have some overall comments. I want to acknowledge the intense effort that's gone into this project and attempts to make it tasteful and fit. I want to point out some areas where I don't believe it does fit as well. The parking garage, I'm not fully clear, and I haven't been able to get an understanding here today of the relationship of this parking garage to the hotel as a unified permitted project, because my understanding from talking to the city manager's office was that absent the city's participation in the parking garage financially, it would not get built, and yet you're potentially voting on approving a hotel that depends on the parking garage for its parking. So I'm not going to claim to be a lawyer. I'm hoping you've got your head around that issue, but I think that's the wrong location for a parking garage. I think that we have a very logical, it's just going to take some more work by our community leaders to use the deep well from the Thrush down to the sheriff's office for a parking garage that fits much better and less intrusive. I've seen the parking garages, especially in Brattleboro.
Mr. Whitaker, I'm going to interrupt.
Sure.
Apologies. Since you've been on a regional planning commission and you have a degree, you must be familiar with the premise that the DRB acts on the application that's submitted to us. We don't redesign projects, nor do we really want to take testimony from city residents who wish the project were redesigned or wish a parking garage were being erected somewhere else on someone else's property. So if you could really please address your comments to the, to the application that's before us.
The application appears to not fit well with the new transit center in that in anticipating train traffic and less car traffic coming into town. This is in effect gonna have a big ominous five-story back end up against the transit center. And that's doesn't seem to be well thought out in regards to anticipating a future where we are more dependent on train travel in and out of town.
Passenger train travel through the city of Montpelier?
Yes. Those plans are in works with the Vermont Agency of Transportation to and from the junction and from Barrett. And my point is that should be a key concern because this entire facade faces the parking lot, not the train station. And in fact, there's barriers, extensive barriers I see on the backside of that. I'm not trying to redesign it. I'm trying to say that the blocking of the views of town, the architectural mandate dictated by Hampton Inn and Suites. I'm even a Hilton Honors member, so I've stated plenty of these, but it's not in keeping with Montpelier's architecture. It's being dictated by a franchising entity that might not be the franchising entity 10 years from now or 20 years from now. So I would exercise extreme caution on those points. But I believe that blocking our view and pushing a five-story behemoth up against the river and bike path and transit center is, this might be more appropriate in the site where the existing hotel lives now, rather than trying to crowd it in between. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, is it appropriate for me to ask a question of the applicant in response to this, or would you like to take all testimony at once and then process
I think this
it?
Is probably the appropriate time.
Okay. I seem to recall testimony from one of the early hearings that you were given, as the, get my words right, as the franchisee, you're given autonomy over design. Do I remember that correctly, and is that true?
That's correct, and if you were to go to Hilton's development site and look at what a standard Hampton Inn looks like, this looks nothing like that. The traditional mixture of brick and limestone and the sort of traditional architectural elements that we brought in were specifically my thought process as far as what I felt was appropriate in Montpelier, given that it's a city with the vast majority of its buildings are over 100 years old. We didn't go with something modern. Decided to go with something traditional. I'll address the rest of his comments as we go through those specific parts of the criteria, but that's a misleading, it's an untrue statement.
Okay. My question was not to endorse or not endorse the feedback, but more to check my memory and the facts of the previous testimony, so thank you for confirming that.
Step forward, please.
My name is Nate Stearns. I'm an attorney at Hutchinson, Carter, Scott, and McGee. I'm working with the Christ Episcopal Church to help them analyze the current project and the impact on their property. In response to what Mr. Rabideau said, I can confirm that we are working on a memorandum of understanding. It's not agreed to yet. There are a number of details that still need to be worked out. And they relate both to the potential for a future housing project by the church, and so we appreciate the applicant's willingness to work with us on thinking through that process and how that could integrate in the future, but also the impacts on the property just as it exists today. And I do want to walk over to the site plan. The church currently has a right-of-way that that comes through the existing parking to access their parking area, which is shown back here. And so we're concerned with what some of the impacts of the project might be on how that right-of-way gets maintained and how the project integrates with the existing church property. In particular, there's a proposal to lift the grade where the parking garage is so that there would be roughly a 4-foot differential between the church's parking area and the grade at the entrance to the parking garage. Paul Boisvert is here from Engineering Ventures. He's been working with Dubois & King and Mr. Rabideau to work through some of those issues. And I don't think anything's changed since Friday. The engineers had a meeting on Friday to talk through some of these issues. There are some details still to be worked out. I guess we can hear tonight if any of those have been addressed in the last couple of days. At some point, it can either be now or it can be after the presentation. We would like to just put those concerns on the record as they relate to the access to stormwater, ADA access, things like that.
Well, as I'm sure you appreciate, there are private property rights over which the DRB has no authority, and the right-of-way that was granted to the church by either this owner or predecessor in title are measured by civil law, not by the zoning ordinance. And certainly to the extent there are elements of this project that might have a direct impact upon a right-of-way, we'd be happy to hear it if it's relevant under the zoning ordinance, the criteria that we have to measure the project against. But also, as you know, there's other forums for differences of opinion between adjoining property owners as to whether there's an encroachment or a interference with the rights that arise under a right-of-way or an easement. So although in the spirit of being neighborly, we take a lot of extraneous evidence and testimony in these kind of matters, I guess we'll take testimony probably when we get to those issues, but we'd like it to be addressed explicitly to the criteria under the ordinance, not to whatever kind of disputes might arise between adjoining property owners.
Understood, and we're well aware of that, and we're here mostly just to, as you suggest, talk about the relevant issues and just to get those on the record. And some of the details that go into the site plan are going to impact us in a variety of ways.
Right, and the impact upon that property under site plan criteria is that's admissible testimony, and we're happy to take that.
And you know, we do very much appreciate the applicant trying to work through this process collaboratively with us. We just thought it was prudent to come here tonight and participate.
Great, thanks. Okay. Any other general statements? Right, then what I'm going to suggest, Ms. Craig, is that we conduct design review of the project.
Yes.
That's an area of our jurisdiction that's isolated, I think, from the other issues that arise under site plan and design and conditional use. So I understand our materials indicate to us that on March 5th, the design review committee voted 3-0 in favor of the project with several recommendations. One is that cornice materials at the top of the hotel building will be a darker color, compatible with the mansard roof material color to better address compatibility with adjacent building and forested hillside background. Is the applicant in agreement with that recommendation?
We agree with that.
Has the design been modified to incorporate that?
Not all the rendered materials are, but we will incorporate it into the construction drawings.
color selection.
The second recommendation was, sorry, you were there, the word preference is used, which is not exactly compelling language, but it's preference for green wall plantings to be evergreen for better year-round appearance.
The planting schedule that was in your package reflected that change. James is here to comment on what those plant material changes are, if anybody's curious to get into the weeds on that, no pun intended.
My weeds come back annually.
Under vines, Boston ivy was one of the ones, and I think the...
The English ivy,
yeah. So those materials have been changed on the schedule, it's in your package.
Do members of DRB wish to take testimony as to what the plantings are going to be?
There will be slightly different planting schedules depending on solar exposure, but we will incorporate the requested evergreen plantings.
Has the applicant given any thought to ensuring the future health and virility of vitality of the plantings?
Well, I think proper soil preparation at planting and stuff will help, but I think our biggest asset in this regard is that we have the Hilton Corporation, who will continue to maintain franchise jurisdiction over this thing, and they routinely come through and do property improvement inspections, and if landscaping is dead or otherwise, they'll force the franchisee to replace the materials. Plus, we'll have, you know, there's going to be on-site management here. This is, unlike an apartment building, there's going to be a desk staff, and hospitality is a little bit different than an apartment building. They sort of need to maintain their good looks to keep people coming in the door, but I think there's enough corporate oversight on this that it should be fine. If the board wants to establish a bonding requirement or something like that, that's certainly reasonable.
Well, so somewhere between bonding and things should be fine, there's got to be a better solution.
We have a standard permit condition having to do with maintenance of any required landscaping. Is that right?
Under the site plan, landscaping and under site plan, yep.
Okay. The next design review issue that design review committee raised was I'll be honest with you, the other members of the board, I'm not sure where the design review committee imagined it had authority over this subject, but they're suggesting an adjustment to the scope of the proposal, that a memorandum of understanding with the proposed Christ Church project should or will address the raised elevation of the parking lot, the maintenance of the parking garage and its green wall, and coordinating the church project parking access issues. Am I alone in believing that that's not within the scope of the design review committee's authority?
I agree with you, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, no, I think you're right on.
Is there an argument to be made that it is a design issue or an aesthetic issue? We've talked about it mostly so far in terms of the function of the site. And that's how I have been thinking about it as well.
But it's so ambiguous. It just doesn't give us any direction. I would be very hesitant to include any kind of a condition that went to the that on the basis of the recommendation from the DRC that addressed the raised elevation of the parking lot, maintenance of the parking garage and perhaps its green wall, and coordinating the church property parking access issues. I think we'll address those other issues under site plan and conditional use, but very hesitant about addressing them under design review.
Agreed. I don't even see any way to adjust that to make it. So I don't, it's out of place.
Well, earlier we took a vote to deliberate, adjourn and go into deliberative session when the record's closed. I suggest we continue that right now, and if the applicant or the parties don't object, I guess we'll determine we're going to close the record on the design review element of our project review.
I don't object to that.
So, well, we'll leave the record open in case any other evidence comes in that impacts design review, but I don't think we need to, I think we can move on from design review.
So if I understand, I'm speaking for the applicant and the design team, and we're committed to pursuing this memorandum of understanding as a separate civil matter. I agree with your sense of where it belongs in the process, but I don't want to, in that sort of complaining about that or whatever, challenging it, I don't want it to seem like we're going soft on our commitment to them. But from your perspective, I can totally get it.
All right, moving on from design review elements of the project, go to site plan elements. Yes.
We just can't hear you back there. If your mics could be down, we talk more than you really, and especially the gentleman at the table.
Okay.
It would really help.
Okay.
Testing. Sarah, based upon our, we have a very comprehensive report that's provided to the DRB by Sarah as the zoning administrator, and she raises she directs us and raises important issues about the project. The site plan questions that you raise are fairly discreet. If you could raise them, the comments you have in a serial fashion, and then we'll ask the applicant to address them, and we can move on from there.
Sure. Most of the items that I pulled out as staff comments are mostly minor inconsistencies between the landscaping plan and the civil site plan or the engineering drawings. Some of the things just, they're not consistent, and like I said, they're relatively minor. One item was snow storage. The location of snow storage was shown on some of the on the landscape plan and then the engineer drawing, but they didn't match, as well as I think the loading area, that was one item to be discussed in previous drawings. There was a loading area which is required under the ordinance, but then on the site plan that I was provided a couple weeks ago, that was omitted. So that's something to just talk about. DPW has provided comments. I don't think they raised any major issues. There's a few inconsistencies about the number of parking spaces, and based on the application site plan, just to have it be consistent, of we know exactly how many existing parking spaces are and how many are proposed. And I think some of this, I see it from my eyes, because in 2 or 3 years, we as the city want to make sure whatever is potentially approved is able to be, we can administer it. Right. So I think even though some of the issues seem kind of minor, I think it's important to, what if approved, whatever plan is succinct. So the landscaping was sent on several occasions, sent over to the tree board, and they've provided comments. We've had several TRC meetings. One issue that will One outstanding issue is the floodplain approval, which is outside of, that's regular, or reviewed by the floodplain coordinator and through A&R as well, but that's outside the DRB's review. But otherwise, I think most of my comments were relatively minor.
So, I'm gonna start with one issue, and that is the, there's a one-story rear addition.
Yes.
To the hotel. And, the zoning ordinance, says that the minimum height requirement in CB1 is two stories, however, up to 20% of the building footprint may be one story. Applicant needs to provide the total building footprint and the footprint area of the addition to ensure that conformance with this district height requirement is met.
That, that little tray that slides out of the back of the building is for the swimming pool, and we didn't pick up on that as part of your regulations because we thought we clearly had a five-story building, so we were compliant, but I'm just getting the architecturals because it's a 10,000 square foot footprint, and I believe that the portion of that building that sticks out on the first floor is, it's 31 and a half feet by, by 31, so it's 630 square feet out of a 10,000 square foot footprint. So it is less than 10%.
Does the 10,000 square foot feet include the parking garage?
No. No, okay. The parking garage has its own footprint.
All right.
If you were, it would only make it more compliant.
This is true.
In addition, can you advise us what the proposed height of the hotel roof deck is? Well, it's shown as 56 feet. It should include mechanicals.
The there are several datum elevations on the building because we wanted to make sure the building didn't come off as being sort of monolithic. So there are three different roof deck elevations, the highest of which is at 156 feet to the deck. And if you refer to page A200 in the architectural drawings, you'll see they're all labeled there. That 56 feet is to the structural deck, and then you can see there's a little bit of parapet that sticks up above that. And then the other roof decks are at 153.4 and at 151.6. And that is, it's based on a imaginary first floor of 100, so it's 56 feet to the from the first floor to the surface of the roof, okay, not including the trim elements.
And the mechanicals are all beneath the carpet?
There wouldn't be any above the 156 elevation. We're doing a type of mechanical system where for fresh air makeup, that's going to be enclosed in a closet inside the building, for performance purposes. The only thing that sticks up above that is the extension of the elevator, which is a code requirement. And there's also a little extension on the laundry chute, which is also a fire code requirement. And you can see those again on page 8200. In real life, they'd be in the middle of the building. They, in the elevation form, they look like they're right there, but my opinion is the average person standing on State Street won't see those elements.
The city's Department of Public Works did raise a question about in circulation. as it relates to access to Taylor Street. And the essence of the point is that it appears to run along the edge of the parking areas, parking spaces.
So it runs across the front facade of the hotel.
Yes.
And there is a short section of these spaces. There are 9 parking spaces where those parking spaces cross the sidewalk.
It's not a sidewalk, it's a hatched walking area, is it not?
We could put a special material there, or we could cast a concrete sidewalk in lieu of the pavement if he's looking for better demarcation. There is another sidewalk that runs along the back side of the hotel, also out to Taylor Street, but it really gets backed down right here, so. Public Works is right in terms of their comment. I guess the question is, are you asking us what we might do about that?
Well, the suggestion is that the preferred design would be around the front of the parking spaces rather than behind the parking spaces.
Okay.
So pedestrians wouldn't be walking on the front side of those parking spaces. DPW had wondered whether or not it could be redesigned so that the sidewalk follows. I don't know how to explain it, but. Right.
Well, it certainly could be.
Yeah, there's room right there. There's a small retaining wall on the hotel side of those spaces, so we potentially have to lose one spot just to come out enough to put in a parking, I mean, to put in a sidewalk there, but it is doable.
I think that one issue that we thought it was, well, it's kind of it's not ideal, but in some ways this sidewalk provides the desired line of pedestrian travel.
I'm sorry, I can't follow you.
Just from pedestrian coming from Taylor Street, normally not wanting to buy the railroad tracks and come back into the parking or pedestrian lane, tend to want to follow the road and come in straight to the hotel. And presence of the hotel here kind of creates a line that makes a pedestrian not desirable. So we may end up with this configuration by moving the sidewalk behind it, still get a fair amount of traffic along the road. So it's probably it's not ideal, but it has some advantages as far as the location itself. Desire lines.
But on the other hand, if you delineate that as a walking area, then that gives pedestrians the false sense of security that they're safe in that area, correct? And that's not communicated to those who are parking in those parking spaces.
I think that's where the changes, and it would be really important to look at some changes in that texture
material.
And coloration and signage on that section of the walk.
Well, we generally defer to the input and advice of the Department of Public Works. Their suggestion to us is that the preferred design would have the directed walking area to be at the front of those spaces rather than at the rear of them.
I don't want to be argumentative. If it's a small enough detail, if it's the sense of the board that they would like us to do that in the manner suggested by DPW, then we'll stipulate that we will.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I think another factor we might contemplate leads into the next item we'll probably discuss, which is snow storage. The area that we're talking about is delineated as either temporary snow storage or snow storage, depending on which diagram we're looking at. I'm generally in favor of the sidewalk doing this new configuration that we've been discussing. If we did do that, would it undermine the snow storage or conflict with the proposed snow storage location?
I mean, I could see a point at which the snow would pile up high enough that it might start spilling onto that sidewalk. You know, we wouldn't want to put any kind of fence or physical barrier there because the idea is to get people onto the sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
This came up, I think, at the staff level, I think probably at one of our technical review meetings, that the project provides more parking spaces than required by your ordinance. And so we felt that we could take spaces out of service for snow storage on a temporary basis. But operationally, the hotel wants as many of those spaces as they can get. So I think the practice is now is that after they get the initial site opened up, that mm-hmm. they remove the material from the site.
Is that right, Rich?
Right. I'm sorry. You guys ship snow off the site right now?
All the time. Anytime they get storage block spaces,
so these,
get rid of it all.
So these blocked out spaces aren't intended to collect all the snow from an entire winter. They're intended to give them some place to pile it up until they can remove it from the site.
Okay.
And I can imagine there might be times when that snow piles over onto that sidewalk. But
okay.
I think that's probably true of
many sidewalks in town.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
All right. So that's not as big of a conflict as I might have thought, given the temporary nature of the snow storage. One consideration I would add, again, in favor of this reconfiguration is if you have people who are very petite or children or wheelchair users who are going on that as designed now, that would add an extra hazard for drivers who are not expecting traffic behind them. So I think this change is probably very positive for a number of reasons.
Sarah had called us with her concerns about some of these inconsistencies. I did direct our engineering team to get with the landscape people and iron that out. I believe that those corrections have been made. If you think it's useful, I'll invite them up to describe, you know, what they did. If you'd rather keep moving, I'm okay with that as well. But we did get a heads up on these issues and the plans as they exist now have been corrected.
I think our primary objective is that the final plans are consistent with the outlines, the representations that are made,
yes,
and they reflect the comments that have come from both Sarah and the board,
yeah,
and DPW. So we don't need to go through them. If you say that they're going to be incorporated in the plans, well, we'll look over the plans.
Okay, that's good. Thank you.
How does the board feel about discussing the parking lot operations agreement with the city? My view is that it's irrelevant. They could have a parking lot agreement with the Vatican.
I do have one note for the record from City Manager Bill. And it just reads, at this point, there's no actual plan for city parking. We are negotiating with the Becerras for a possible TIF project, but the zoning permit application is theirs and so far does not involve the city.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and it's not unlike the arrangements that we have on Main Street, in the rear of the French Block and things like that, where the city has leasehold interest around Aubuchons and things like that. The city, in this context, the city is just another civil party to an agreement for the use of real estate. So. Moving on. Sarah, has you have questions about the mechanicals, the rooftop mechanicals thing?
No.
I'm quickly addressed. I thought it had been. Okay. questions or comments from DRB members concerning site plan elements?
DPW did have a question about, on the drawings, it shows a connection to the city's bike path, in the corner behind the parking garage, and, whether or not they're proposing a retaining wall, around there.
Yeah, one of them's labeled as a temporary wall.
Mm-hmm.
Coordinated our design with Stan Tech, who's undertaking the bike path. They're happy, we've actually moved the retaining wall. This is the updated site plan, it's actually showing the.
So do we have this?
Okay, so.
Is that, take a look at it, make sure it's the latest one.
L100, March 20th.
Yes, there is a retaining wall now. That we are showing along here, so we brought the grade up to where they have the proposed bridge, and we're actually, have included a little area for bikers to take a rest and bike repair tools. Stan Tech's very happy with that design, so they're gonna amend their drawings to show our grading.
And are those shown on your engineering drawings as well, or just the landscape plan?
Yeah, you guys are all synced up.
Yeah, they're.
After your call, I called both of them and said, lock yourselves in a room and get it together.
No, we haven't, and this plan that I have here shows them all, everything's been, put together.
Temporary retaining wall is actually on the other side towards the Christ Church, so is there, are there retaining walls being put into this plan around the garage and the parking lot, is that?
Just the one.
The one that we're talking about, in the bottom corner there is a permanent retaining wall.
Right, I'm changing to a different question.
Right.
So what is the nature of those temporary retaining walls?
Well, the church, has sort of near-term problem, which is how do we make their existing parking and rear entrance and some sort of work, and then they have a longer-term issue, which is hopefully, if everything goes well, they'll come in with an addition on the church to contain some apartments. So our thought process to now has been that at some point, that apartment building and stuff will do some of the work that a temporary retaining wall might be required until they get around to that bigger project. So our discussions have focused on using something unitary, like a masonry system that can be dismantled if and when they ever go to build that apartment complex, so we're not throwing $100,000 worth of concrete into a dumpster. That's why they're described as temporary.
And they're to account for the differences of grade required when you build the garage?
Well, it's mostly the hotel. The floodplain regulations required us under the old regs, which we're still under, for this application, we had to raise our finished floor elevation a foot above a defined elevation. There's a process, and they issued a certificate, which you have. It's really that floodplain regulation, which will apply to their future project equally. But there may be a period of years between when we finish our project and when they start theirs, so we need to have that settled. Broadly speaking, our attitude has been that improvements beyond our property line on the church property will be subject to a future application where the church is the applicant and they have their own consultants. But we are working together to sort these things out so that when they come in, their stuff meshes with ours.
And so those walls are temporary but indefinite. Is that
fair?
Well,
they're necessary to build this project. They may ultimately go away when the church does whatever it does in the future.
So there's no reason to think we're abandoning their parking area. You're going to raise it with temporary and
yes,
a temporary level, so we have a net.
This board
of no
will
loss.
This board will see an application from Christ Episcopal Church at some date in the future that shows that parking lot put back together, and the Capitol Plaza folks, to the extent that they're the predicate for all this, are participating financially in the development of those features.
Well, are we going to have use of those parking spaces, or are we gonna have a hole to look down for a while?
Well, it's up to the church, but it seems to us that if right now our discussions are focused on retaining the accessible handicap ramp that goes in the back of the church, goes in through the church hall. There's a Bilco door that goes to their cellar that needs to, the access to that needs to be preserved. So no, I mean, ultimately, by the time we get to groundbreaking in November, hopefully we'll have that sorted out, but the, our conversations to date have been, at least for the next couple of years, that has to function as a parking lot. And if the project ever turns into an apartment building, at that point, they may park in this parking garage, and their lot will be occupied by apartments. But that's all still in process. But there's no claim to rescind their easement or anything like that. It's really just, the only thing that, the only reason we haven't come in with something so far is it's really sort of theirs to do, but also they've been waiting for the snow to melt so they could get out there and take some accurate measurements of various features that'll have to be considered in this, design.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Sure.
So is the temporary retaining wall that's shown on the landscape plan and presumably the engineer drawings between the lot, the 100 State Street, and then the Christ Episcopal Church, is that temporary retaining wall proposed under this project, or are you guys asking for a permit or to be that to, for that to be part of the project, or is that something that we expect a future application on? And I only make note of it because
design review.
Right, fences and walls do require design review, and those improvements haven't been reviewed by DRC at this point.
Right, and it depends on whose land it falls on in the end. What I would suggest is that the church has hired a surveyor, apparently, or they're going to hire a surveyor. We let them collect that information, and when we'll have to come in with some kind of application for improvements on their land, even if it's just the restoration of the parking lot. And we probably ought to fold that in there because they all work together. But yeah, we didn't talk about that with DRB or DAB. I'm sorry. So
the temporary temporary retaining wall. You've depicted that on the applicant's land, have you?
Yeah, we have.
Right. So do you have an idea of what it's, the size of its face?
One of the sections shows the relationship between the parking and the garage.
Put that together.
What material the wall's gonna be made out of? It?
No, just the relationship of the grade change in section D.
111. Show scale. Can you tell us what that is?
Don't have a scale. My understanding that it's only a 3-foot wall.
Well, and we had a detailed meeting with Engineering Venture on Friday. The group's goal, our goal, their goal, is to try to bring that change of grade down as much as possible. But in order to make that determination, they have to finish the survey work on the church property for us to get some control elevations. But this would represent this section D on L101.1. That would represent kind of the worst case scenario.
So it would be a temporary retaining wall not to exceed?
Yes.
Blank. Not to exceed what?
I would say probably by site datum elevation, probably the top of that wall would be no greater than 525.
That's right, and then, yeah, so between 3 and 4 feet is the height of that wall.
Yeah.
Still can't for the 4 feet of elevation change as you go across the parking lot.
I'm sorry?
It's to account for the 4 feet of elevation change that...
Well, you know, the far end of the church parking lot where the handicap ramp is at elevation 523. Drop inlet right in front of the entrance to the proposed parking garage, the rim elevation on that is 524. So the dramatic change in grade isn't that dramatic. Floor elevation of the Hampton is gonna be 527, so things will build up. Right in this corner here, I expect we'll go from 524 or 525 down to 523, so it's only a couple of feet over, about 80 feet of length. Slopes aren't tremendously bad, we just need to work to make sure that they meet ADA accessibility guidelines, so. And that's our challenge.
I'm circling the wagons. Jack?
Whose challenge is it, the church or yours?
Well, it's something we have to do together, I think. But the design of the parking lot will come in a separate application from the church. And to the extent that these two projects come together along a common boundary, issues may come up during the design of the church's side of this that require us to come back and ask for an amendment to this permit.
So the DRBA doesn't have any other questions about these site plan issues, and I'd like to ask the neighbor. Because these are all relevant site plan questions and, yes, please. Could you identify yourself for the record?
Yeah, Paul Bulgari, and the event. So we did a chance to meet with Greg and Ron, who's back here, start begin talking about how these things work. So the plans as we've seen them currently show 525 at High Point, which then in the church property currently in the parking lot is 4 feet lower. So there is a 4 foot differential to be made up, which affects a number of things for church property. Doesn't mean that just can't be worked out possibly, but we haven't gotten that point yet, and we really, we've been talking about a possible future project. That would be another process. We're trying to figure out most immediately is how to keep the church functioning the way it's functioning right now. So, a 4 foot grade change is a little bit of a challenge for the church, and sloping the parking lot to make that happen, again, would affect how that gets used. And I guess we're gonna then get into these as the criteria come up, right, more specifically.
No, it's the site plan. It's hard to go from one criteria to the next, so it's just a generic discussion.
ADA access for the church currently, work from the front from State Street. From this direction, it's all and access into the back of the church here. So we're concerned. We just need to work through and have make sure we still have ADA access. That's the church's only ADA access, and that needs to be maintained. The plan that Greg was referring to, we did talk to them about the potential to drop grades, unless it were changed to 3 feet lower, that would be much more workable. That hasn't really been worked through yet, so I think there's an opportunity there. We haven't been through that process yet. Church is ready to get a survey, but we need this to function in between periods. So.
Paul, let me ask you a question. Is the handicap access to the rear of the church, is that by individuals navigating the parking lot on their own?
Well, it would be, from safety, that is the pedestrian access right now. So
through the center of the parking lot. Yeah.
Not ideal by any stretch, but it's still.
Not ideal.
Not ideal.
No.
And then for vehicles, it's the backside. Potentially could be raised up the painting wall that we're talking about, potentially rectify some of that so I could get back to the grade we need to get to.
Would it be fair to say that that slight increase in the elevation here that might make it a little more difficult for folks for ADA access by pedestrians?
Yes. The slopes that they've shown on their plan does meet the slopes along running on the grade here.
Yes.
Do meet ADA requirements from my review, then we just need to work through how that. church itself, and also it's the memorial garden, which then is, and, you know, it's another piece that has to be through. So there are changes that kind of come with this plan that affect the church's property, so that's what we need to look at.
So it's not as if a perfect plan is being upset by this project?
Well, it's not perfect, but, you know, again, that is what they have. Church has been there a long time.
No, I understand.
Definitely not a deal.
The church predates the ADA.
Okay.
I understand that.
Get to other topics on?
Yes, let's, we're under the tent, we're under the site plan tent.
A few other things, so, you know, again, we talked about options, vehicle access has to work through there, possibly having a lower grade, maybe do a, at some point there's a slope that they speak, and again, looked at for vehicles, including emergency access. One of the things that I'm particularly interested in is stormwater design. A few things that happened here, again, we're creating a high point, so now the memorial garden, which is really difficult to make adjustments to, that's potentially a collection point. Now, I think the storm system is being worked out. You know, we talked about Ron a little bit, but I don't think it's at a point where we really can fully weigh in on it. But I think the potential for the drainage system from the Capitol Plaza project, you know, it's some high elevation there, so when the water comes in, especially during like a shorter duration, 25-year event, the potential is there to surcharge the system and start moving water in the wrong direction back into like the memorial garden area, collecting water.
Can you identify where that is?
That would be right on this side of the church.
Okay.
So that's something these people. Potential to serve charges is a consideration. I'd like to finish working through.
So you're testifying then that the application materials as they're now constituted don't adequately address the stormwater?
Yeah, I haven't seen anything today that fully addressed that. So
I guess I would qualify that by saying it more than adequately describes what happens at 100 State Street. It's virtually silent on what happens next door on the church property.
Well, I've never seen a stormwater design that didn't take into account adjoining properties.
Well, yeah, I understand that, and we've made provision in the engineering plans for connection points for sewer, sanitary, mm-hmm. water. You know, we've shown in our engineering design valves and connection places where the church can plug in. But all I'm saying is that the improvements on the church property will be shown on a church plan, and that'll include whatever storm stuff has to happen to address this, I think.
I'm sorry, I'm getting a disconnect here. I'm hearing from the neighbor that...
Once we know what's going on their lot, we may have to modify our thing a little bit.
But we know what's going on at the Memorial Garden.
Yes.
Now...
We don't have topography for that memorial garden. Nobody's prepared a survey of what's going on.
But your stormwater design certainly anticipates what happens to surface water at the boundary, does it not?
Yeah, right now the church is just sending water across the hotel property and into catch basins in that parking lot. So the church is directing flows off of their land and onto our land.
So we're going to equalize if we go up 4 feet?
No. I don't.
Rod, do you have anything to add here?
Yeah.
I have a civil engineer. Yeah.
We have started talking about it. I don't think it.
I don't want to mischaracterize it. I'm not trying to mislead anybody.
I think it's, as Paul said, there's some details here that are based on some really fine grading issues in the memorial garden. Mm-hmm. We have on our site plan that's been submitted for discussion with DPW, we're putting connections into our new line that's quite deep actually. It's 18 inches or 24 inches down, 12 feet in that area. So we know that it's a solution to that that's reasonable tying into our line. think one of the things that we're looking at is in this memorial garden, a portion of that goes towards State Street, and a portion goes back towards our ground, and we really don't know yet the details. I think that, after that meeting, we had several discussions of different alternatives, and some of them were just looking at, we need to put any retaining wall or any curb adjacent to our parking, we need to put some relief areas in there, basically just cuts. So there's several areas in storm drainage, and I think we've got all the answers, it's just we need to get down to the details, and it's really important that we understand what the church's thoughts on these are. Detailed grading, so I think we're very close to a solution, but it does take some very detailed survey, and we can talk about, it's going to be trying to get the survey into the computer.
Well, from the DRB's perspective, we're very experienced at understanding how adjoining property owners can collaborate upon issues of common concern to them. But, and we would certainly encourage the neighbors and their engineers and perhaps their attorneys that you can collaborate and reach a mutually agreeable solution. But we need to make findings, affirmative findings about the site plan and its design. So, with all due respect, Paul, I don't think your testimony suggests that this project by itself, that there's a deficiency in the stormwater design of this project. It may have implications for the adjoining property, but is it your testimony that?
I guess I'm not quite sure to answer that because I haven't seen enough details to know. Like, I don't know if you model me or not. We want to feel confident that it's meeting the 25-year requirement that in that condition.
Paul, when were you engaged by the neighbor?
What's that?
When were you engaged by the neighbor? So, have these plans been, how long have the plans been out of the oven?
I think the storm system is, not fully denied. Unless you disagree about how you haven't seen it.
I think it's designed to the point that it's acceptable to Department of Public Works to review and say, yes, we believe this is an acceptable stormwater design as far as collection, conveyance, discharge. It's going to be permanent under state means. At this stage, probably you don't get into the full details of that design. So I think we're comfortable with Public Works is saying, yes, this is a permanent design. I think it's designed, one of the things that Public Works had put in the meeting with them is that put in a connection to our system to allow drainage on the church property. We did that. Put a 12-inch line into that property plugged off so they can connect to it. So I think we complied with everything we can. We want the church property to design their property as such without their understanding, permission, and cooperation. And I think that's coming. I think it's just a matter of, is it tonight, what's going to take to connect to that line that we've been asked to put in? I'm not sure. So I think we're comfortable with her. Very close to saying here's a solution on our project that addresses everything that the church would have to conserve. And I think, quite honestly, DPW has been working towards that because everyone was, gee, you really should put this line in. We should do it. So we'll work with the city and the church and make sure we do have a system that works for our neighbors.
Well, except that the Department of Public Works' primary concern is with the infrastructure, the city's infrastructure. And they're forward-looking. They anticipate stormwater from other sites in the area as well, which is what they customarily do in all instances. But as the DRB, we're charged with taking evidence on site plan elements of this project, and we get, we'll take evidence from a neighbor that suggests that there are potential difficulties with stormwater exiting this site onto their site. And if that's, we have a different measure of whether the plans are approvable. At least this, I'm one member of the board.
I think that's where this is a little different than some designs. We do have some collaboration in the church, it's pretty critical. And quite honestly, I think lots of the church plans were full of early in our design game, is that looking at house and looking at different plans from the church, and there wasn't a tremendous amount of push to say that they're due off the top now for the church parking lot, because that would have been housing. And I think where we were directed, I think it was the correct direction, was to put the church and say it's got to be something that works for the church both now and project that's going to be submitted as part of the church involvement, not church involvement, but unilaterally saying here's what we're
doing. There's no question, I mean, we understand the parties aren't at loggerheads. We just need to make our way through the evidence and the record as it stands right now. So, go ahead, Paul, you have other observations?
I'm assuming, you know, when they get to doing the storm permit, they'll be doing modeling and things looking at the flows and what the potentials are for backflow houses, how water moves through the system, the different events. You know, I have my able to weigh in on that, and I just want to make sure that, you know, at the end of the day, the church ends up having water going in the right direction. Even during like a short duration, 25 years, so unless there's some of the critical ones in place, like the popular area.
We know water around here. Thank you.
When we went through technical review, we were left with the impression that the level of completeness of the stormwater design was about 60%. That we didn't have to be 100% complete to go through this process. So I apologize if we haven't nailed down some of this fine-grained stuff. It was just our understanding of how the process worked. So
I understand. Unless it have an impact on a neighbor, then the issue wouldn't come up.
No. Everyone freely acknowledges it, and the data collection process is ongoing to solve those problems.
I think DPW is just making note that the actual fine-tuning of the utility and stormwater designs, some of that stuff happens below ground, and it can, there's some minor changes that can happen through their permitting process. But from the board's jurisdiction and the board's authority, I mean, looking even at conditional use and how the project impacts, the off-site impacts, basically.
Okay. Let me also ask about the retaining wall that we see along the, it's along the common boundary with the church. Do you think this falls sufficiently, is this temporary retaining wall of sufficient breadth and scope to trigger DRC review?
And the one along the bike path, I think, is permanent. It's the temporary one is between Christ Church, but then there's a new one along the bike path that is permanent, I believe. Right?
Yeah. How long is the retaining wall along the bike path?
50 feet.
50 feet? But it's more of a landscape element, is it not? Is it provided as this for seating?
It's the idea is that we're going to raise the grade of the bike path instead of having a retaining wall between the bike path and our access to the bike path. We're going to bring the bike path up to our level, so it's free access for the pedestrian. It's retaining the grade to make the bike path more accessible from our side.
So, Sarah?
And I can just recite what the ordinance says, that fences and walls are subject to design review. I think it's 709 or 305C.
put a place mark there and move on. Any other comments, observations about site plan issues? Kate?
Did we want to discuss the loading area? Was that on our list, or are you still going through that list?
Oh, I wasn't going to go through it one by one, just in general, site plan issues, yes.
I didn't know if that was one the board wanted to review, based on Sarah's comment on page 13 of the staff report.
You had that, Greg?
I'm only raising it because I think it was raised earlier in Sarah's walk.
Yeah, I forgot. And so this parcel is obviously in design control. The ordinance does give the board the authority to grant waivers for off-street or off-street loading areas. At one point, there was an off-street loading area, I think, closer to the Taylor Street intersection, but then that was omitted on the plans that I reviewed.
So there's a couple things going on.
Thank you.
Right now, if you visit the project site, you'll see that there's a portion of the building that people park underneath. Mm-hmm. And New Grade is going to be raising up here. We've got a little retaining wall here around that area so that that becomes kind of our work yard. Mm-hmm. Dumpsters are intended to be underneath that enclosed space, so they'd be screened from the public by using the building. You did mention that this cutout in the curb here is a loading and offloading area, but that would be for cars, buses, that would be for hotel guests. Because right now what happens is trucks pull in off of Taylor Street and they just sort of park right in here and they offload into the hotel via this series of doors here. I think there is going to continue to be the occasional truck traffic that comes onto the site. These particular spaces in here will largely be used by employees, so I expect that there'll probably be trucks in here still, but the large work area, most of the work stuff is in this sort of work yard that we're creating here.
Thank you.
Going to go out on a limb and suggest that those parking spaces are not likely to be used by employees, but more like management. It's just so close to the building that it would be a shame if rank and file use those parking lots.
I wouldn't be surprised if the Bashara, if you had a lot of Basharas parking there. But
just a guess.
The Hampton Inn itself does not have a restaurant or a commercial laundry in it. It serves breakfast, a prescribed list of breakfast items. We don't anticipate the new hotel requiring a lot of additional truck traffic. Most of these franchisees just go to Costco and buy bulk stuff. But the existing hotel and certainly the restaurant that's there now will continue to have the level of traffic they have today.
And you said the laundry for the Hampton Inn and Suites is on site?
It's going to be, they're going to consolidate and have one laundry for the two properties.
Okay, okay.
So the laundry facility in the Capitol Plaza will do double duty.
Thanks. Curiosity satisfied about parking and loading spaces. They're now indicated on the plans.
Mm-hmm.
Was that a question, Kate?
Not anymore.
Okay.
I was curious about whether we needed more information or needed to actually delineate the parking and loading spaces based on a staff comment, but those spaces have been delineated. So, yes, thank you.
So, any other issues or comments about the site plan? I'm hesitant to move on to conditional use review, because we have an outstanding site plan issue, and that is whether the temporary retaining walls are walls that are subject to the review and comment jurisdictional review of the design review committee. We don't have primary jurisdiction over those matters. Those go to the design review committee first, and then they review and make a recommendation to the DRB. We're not wed to their recommendation, although we defer to them regularly. I would feel very uncomfortable about initiating review of those walls at the DRB level.
Okay.
And I understand what that means about the progress of the project, but I feel like we're in a box canyon.
Yeah, there's nothing we can expedite. They have to go through the process of collecting the information we discussed earlier this evening, and that there has to be some concord between the parties as far as what those look like. I was hoping that
the retaining wall.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So. Although there is testimony that they're somewhere between 3 and 4 feet, you can't really design them until you know what's on the other side of the wall.
That's true. I don't know a way around it. I mean, other than issuing a permit that specifically excludes those walls, requiring us to come back. Otherwise, the other option is we go away from here tonight with nothing. At some point, we have the answers. I'm a little uncomfortable about that just because I don't control the process of collecting the data, but I understand your condition, your situation.
Do you guys have any plans for like materials or anything like that? Could you develop those to present to DRC at their next meeting?
We can certainly talk about materials. Because I think we've been talking about a sort of off the rack unitized mm-hmm. retaining wall system, which could be anything from, could be cut stone or dry laid stone, or it could be one of those masonry products. But to get accurate vertical control on it, we'll have to settle some of these other issues with our neighbor.
And I usually rely on DPW to provide like just a technical kind of review of things like that. So if you had any of those details, I would forward them to DPW for their comment.
So it's unlikely to be just poured concrete?
No, for two reasons. A poured in place foundation or retaining wall would have to have a counter for it in it, a big footing that goes out into the ground. And we don't want to do anything that heads into the church property, because we're likely to run into interred remains.
Like to run into what?
Interred remains. I think there are cremation urns and stuff in that memorial.
Okay.
Right? So, I mean, the memorial garden isn't just a peaceful place. I think
it's not a euphemism.
Right.
Okay.
The other thing is, as I mentioned earlier, if they do a project in the future, there's a strong likelihood that the retaining wall in this location would get demoed in favor of the new apartment building. So we want to use something we can take back apart and reuse somewhere, I guess.
Yeah. I'm interested in exploring all possibilities, even though this may not actually end up being a possibility. I'll ask anyway. Has the Development Review Board ever approved something contingent upon DRC review and approval of one outstanding item?
Not to my knowledge. Because it would be hard for DRC to make a recommendation to us if we already approved it.
I know that sometimes we approve things based on, you know, pending final plans or pending final diagram showing something we discussed. I didn't know if this would be a similar situation, pending a final diagram showing a wall that we discussed that was not concrete.
I don't think that's possible.
Okay.
Well, the regulations say walls, but they don't say temporary walls.
I think there's two walls being proposed, am I right? There's a permanent wall being proposed and then a temporary retaining wall too, right? Or
yeah, the permanent one's associated with the bike path. And that's us accommodating the city's project, and
right.
We're talking about a lot. Yeah.
And that will be on private property, right? Or within?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Do you know the design elements of that, the material, all of that? Is that known?
Not sufficient for your purposes, I don't think. Well, we know the size and shape and location of it, but I'm not here prepared to show you what it's made of or the color of it.
So, no good deed goes unpunished.
I appreciate you digging around and trying to find a way to make this work, but I have a feeling my head's in the noose either way.
Well, you know.
Wrong metaphor.
it's no good deed goes unpunished because the applicant has sought to accommodate the bike path and ameliorate the impact of the project on the bike path. Now you find yourself with a wall that you've agreed to create without a design. Nevertheless, the other temporary retaining walls around the neighbor's property already present us with a loose end. So what's the pleasure of the applicant? We could continue with the conditional use review tonight.
I'd like to get through as much stuff as possible because I don't want to come back yet again and then find some fresh new hell. So something may come out of that needs our attention.
Right, then I'd like to ask for a 5-minute recess then before we undertake a review of the conditional use criteria. We're recessed for 5 minutes. We're going to return to the hearing. Folks, we're going to go back on the record. So we'll begin with the conditional use criteria. Conditional use approval may be granted by the DRB only if the DRB determines that the proposed use does not adversely affect the following: capacity of existing or planned community facilities, Sarah, can you supplement? Can you
sure. So
outline
for just this
review committee.
Sure. So the application was originally, I think, submitted back in November, and we've had several TRC meetings, I think, since that time. Not recently, but since that time we have. And police, fire department, building inspector, floodplain, all city departments are invited to review and comment, and no one really raised any major issues. They've been working through DPW permitting to make sure that there's adequate municipal a water and sewer and stuff like that, but I think they've addressed everything.
Traffic report was prepared, and then additional questions were answered. And
that's a different criteria.
But I think from between DPW and the information we got at our TRC meetings, I think that everyone agreed that it wouldn't adversely affect community facilities.
Thank you. The second criteria is the character of the area affected. This project is located in the CB1 zoning district, and which is suitable for commercial, retail, and other like uses, and appears to be consistent with the design of the CB1 district. Next criteria is traffic on roads and highways in the vicinity. We have a trip generation distribution analysis prepared by RSG. We also have testimony from DPW that I'm not sure that DPW's comments were updated on March 28th. Correct?
Yep.
And so based upon that later review, DPW, I think, has concluded that that it will not adversely affect traffic.
Yeah, DPW.
In the area.
Yeah, they had in their last sentence, they stated that we agree with the overall conclusion that the hotel project will result in a modest increase in peak hour traffic, which we believe will be manageable and not have adverse on existing or planned facilities.
I think DRB can also take notice of the development by the city of the adjoining site on the other side of the railroad tracks, and the fact that Taylor Street is going to be reconstructed in connection with that project. And so some of the obvious difficulties that Taylor Street presents now may well not be continued far into the future. And Greg, it is accurate, isn't it, that the Taylor Street exit has been designed to be compatible with the ingress and egress at the transit center, adjacent transit center?
They don't conflict with each other.
Well, one takes into consideration the other. I mean, Taylor Street access is already there.
Right.
So the transit center had to take into account the existence of the Capitol Plaza interchange there.
Right, and that's one of the reasons why we hired the same civil engineer to do this project as is doing the Taylor Street project, to make sure that coordination was there.
Next criteria is the project will not have an adverse effect on the zoning and subdivision regulations in effect. Bear in mind we're assessing this project under a zoning ordinance that's about to depart. It's maybe the last project we review under the zoning ordinance.
One other, Spring Street one. Okay.
The zoning ordinance emeritus, I think is what we call that.
And finally, the project does not appear to restrict access to or interfere with the utilization of renewable energy resources. I think that's a fair,
yes.
You can draw that conclusion. Sir, do you think it's necessary to introduce testimony regarding the expected noise generated by the hotel and parking garage?
I think you can probably safely say that it's not going to adversely affect the character or surrounding vicinity.
Standard vehicular traffic moving through a rather close parking lot. That's going to be
adjacent to a transit center. Further comments, observations about the conditional use criteria?
Has the general project impact review been undertaken as recommended by DPW? The comment from them was a couple meetings ago, having to do with the number of projects happening at the same time in that general area and just the need to assure coordination so that all those sites and the surrounding areas could continue to function. It says the city manager's office is presently investigating possible options relative to accommodations for displaced parking, sequencing projections for each of the respective projects. Is that the kind of thing that continues to be discussed by?
Well, the construction management team for the Taylor Street project is also going to be the construction management team for this project.
Okay.
So a lot of the logistics in terms of where construction people park and stuff mm-hmm. is managed under a single point, which we think will help.
Mm-hmm.
There have been extensive conversations about off-site parking for construction workers, vehicles. There's a couple lots that have been mentioned again and again, but apparently the city or the state has some parking out on the highway bridge or something. But,
right.
So that's an ongoing process, and that'll continue right on through the project, I think.
No doubt.
It'll be intense for a while.
It will. Okay.
It's also during the period of construction, so it's DPW, I think, is suggesting that city fathers, such as it is, give some thought to what will transpire during the period of construction. It's not a conditional use issue.
It isn't, but it was mentioned under the miscellaneous comments, so I know it won't affect our approval one way or another, but good. Those conversations will continue, I'm sure.
So what's the pleasure of the board? My recommendation would be is that we've taken evidence on the conditional use criteria, we've taken evidence on the design review, and we've taken evidence on site plan, but we have two outstanding issues in the site plan review, and that is the final design and configuration of the walls in two areas, one around the Christ Church property and then in the rear towards the bike path. I don't think your plans are finalized for those two issues.
Yeah, I'm afraid I have to concede that point.
Believe me, we don't like to interfere with the progress of project review either. We're very aware of how issues like this can arise. On the other hand, and maybe going off the reservation here, we certainly want to encourage the neighbor to step up and participate actively and promptly and expeditiously to facilitate review of the impact next door so that the applicant can proceed with their design. We understand the delineation between private property rights and what our jurisdiction is, but we also don't like to see private property rights used as leverage in a permitting environment. It's inconsistent with good neighborly relations and proper development in the city. So we encourage collaboration between the parties expeditiously. Anything further from the parties, the applicant?
We started to talk informally about when the next hearings would be.
We don't have any time on our April 16th meeting, and our next meeting after that is May 7th.
I saw that in the motion, or in the draft motion, and I given what I know we have to collect for information, the amount of design work we'll have to do, then I think that would be fine to come back to see you on May 7th.
Does the DRC also meet May 7th?
DRC meets on April 16th, so theoretically you could go to DRC on the 16th, or you could go on May 7th, like the back-to-back kind of thing that we've done in the past, I guess.
I'm going to get with my team, and then I'll call you tomorrow at work, and we'll say which of those dates, unless you need to.
Well, this board needs to continue to a time and date certain. We can decide on DRC.
May 7th, fine for that, but as far as whether or not which of those two hearings.
It doesn't matter for DRC, but for this board, they do.
We've got all the testimony. Is it appropriate that we can close the record?
I don't
with
think
the exception of the walls, or do
I don't
you
think
leave
that's
it
advisable.
Open?
I don't think that's advisable because you can't anticipate whether some element of the redesign of this will have a domino effect or trigger changes elsewhere, and there's no need to close the record. And so I think it'd be ill-advised to do so at this time.
It'd be better to issue a combined decision rather than individual
yes.
decisions.
So, is there a motion then to continue this hearing until May 7th?
I'll make a motion to continue the hearing on 100 State Street to May 7th.
Thank you, Roger. Motion by Roger.
I'll second.
Second by James. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hands. Thank you. We're continued until May 7th.
Thanks for your time and patience.
Thank you.
If you know you'll bring them, then that's fine. But sometimes it's just hard to keep track of who has copies and who has.
Yeah.
We can, if you want, we can just provide you with the new materials.
I will be. It's the next one.
I'm thinking of all those trees and stuff. I'm happy to keep mine, and I promise I'll.
Okay, perfect. And then we'll just provide new and whatever.
I'm not adjourned yet, anyways.
Okay.
Color coding in the staff reports has been very helpful.
Cool.
Yes. You mean the red?
Mm-hmm.
Sarah means business.
Sarah means business.
In red.
Are you going to be here on May 7th?
I guess I have, potentially. It would. We just have to work out the details. I said that I would stay through the, like, to see this project through.
Mr. Chair, are you seeking a motion to adjourn? Mr. Chair, are you seeking a motion to adjourn?
Yes. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Motion by Kate, second by Jack. All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand.
See this little.
We are adjourned.